My name is Sarah Carter. I teach at the University of Alberta, where I'm Henry Marshall Torrey Chair, and I'm in the Department of History and Classics and the Faculty of Native Studies.
So congratulations, Sarah. You're one of the five Killam Prize winners for 2020. It's a fantastic achievement. I guess you must be happy.
Yes, I'm very honored to have been given this award, and I'm very humbled in when I look at the the past recipients of these awards in the humanities, but also in the other disciplines. It's a tremendous company to be included among.
Why don't you start by giving us a brief summary of your area of study?
My research for decades has focused on the Canadian Prairie West, and I focus on the late 19th to early 20th centuries. And within that region, I've looked at quite a variety of topics and issues. My most recent book is about the settler suffragist movement on the Canadian prairies, and about the successes of this settler suffrage movement, but also their limitations and failures, and the blinkered vision that so many of these activists had. Before that, my most recent book was called Imperial Plots, and it's about the gendered system of land allotment on the prairies, and how women were virtually excluded from the 160-acre homestead grant that was available to virtually every immigrant male over the age of 18. And this was quite in contrast to the U.S. West. So it's a study of how in the Canadian prairies, there was this fierce determination to see that women, settler women and Indigenous women, had very few options outside of marriage. So those are the most recent books. Earlier than that, I did a study of how the monogamous model of marriage was imposed on the very diverse peoples of Western Canada, including Indigenous people, but other immigrant groups, including the Mormons, and the way in which marriage was policed and monitored in order to control marriage, and especially women's opportunities, again, ensuring they had few options outside of marriage. And I've worked also, my first book was on agriculture, on First Nations reserves, mainly in southern Saskatchewan. And it was about how there was an era of significant progress in the about the first 15 years after the 1870s treaties. And then the steps that were taken, especially by government, but also by politicians, pressure from settlers, to undermine this success in agriculture through especially a peasant farming policy that limited their acreages and limited their livestock to a cow or two. So there was this deliberate undermining of their economic initiatives and economic hopes for a future of agriculture on First Nations reserves. So those are just samples of some of the work that I've done. There's always a longstanding interest in land, and land is the bedrock and foundation of Western Canadian society and economy. I look at who got land and what people were denied land, and what myths and ideas were circulated about who ought to have land, and how these were very powerful, and how they were translated into policies of the Department of Indian Affairs, as well as the Department of the Interior. And I look at marginalized groups. I look at the history of women and Indigenous people, ordinary people, homesteaders. So I think I'll stop there. Those are some of the ideas that I've developed over many decades.
How do you connect the importance of what you're studying with understanding and hopefully improving today's society and economy?
Well, I think that you can't live in the Prairie West, and you can't live in Canada without realizing the profound legacies of the colonial era, and these legacies surround us. And they surround us in so many ways. We see this very clearly in such issues as investigation into murdered and missing Indigenous women. There's many ways in which we still experience the exclusions and the obstacles to equal rights and opportunities that are really embedded in that era, in that colonial era. And I've always contended that we need to examine and to lay bare those the exclusions and the inequalities of that era to understand how we arrived where we are today and how we can move forward.
What are your thoughts on the idea of reconceptualizing Canada's history, how important that could be to moving ahead into the future, and are there any risks to doing that?
Reconceptualizing history is what historians do all the time. And the way I have written most recently, for example, about the Prairie Settler Women's Suffrage Movement would be very different from how someone would have written about this about, you know, 50 years ago. So the approach would be to celebrate these women as heroines. And my approach is much more critical, is that yes, we should recognize their successes, but we need to recognize also their limitations. And history, not very long ago, even when I started out, was written by a small group of mainly Euro-Canadian white males. And that has changed dramatically over the years that I've been working in this field. Both the number of historians at work and the people in our faculty and history departments has become much more diverse. And they bring very, very different perspectives and different voices and different interests and different approaches. So this is what history is about. It's continually reconceptualizing the past. And I think we need to step away from these former narratives of progress that really characterize the sort of history that was written up until about the 1960s. So I think that your question is also asking about, you're asking about the risks. And I guess I see that there are some risks in that I think we need to be careful in replacing this celebration approach or this narrative of progress. We need to be careful about replacing that with a form of outright condemnation. That is, we used to say they're good and now we're saying they're bad. And I think we need to really recognize more nuance and more complexity. And I don't think we should simplistically label people as just good or bad, but really understand and dig deeper and ask, good or bad, where, what, when, and for whom. So the example of John A. Macdonald is one. I do understand why he has become this lightning rod or symbol of those who want us to clearly recognize the legacies of our colonial past. I do understand that, but I'm also glad that as a student, I really had to study the ideas of John A. Macdonald and to study his politics and to study how he did come to be such an important person in the whole, you know, conceptualization of British North America. And I'm glad that I did learn about him. And I would be very sorry if we were replacing, if we were condemning him and not teaching our students still about some of the things that he did. But we also need to understand why someone like him did have his beliefs and ideas and practices at that time. I guess for me, and addressing reconciliation, when I look at the recommendations of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, I'm very hopeful about their emphasis on education and the need to that we have to have a much more enlightened public. We need to have a more enlightened public about such issues as treaties that are the foundation of the peaceful settler society that that was created here in Western Canada. But we also need to understand such issues as the past system. The past system prevented First Nations people from leaving their reserves for decades without permission from a farm instructor, non-Indigenous, or an Indian agent. It would have had huge repercussions for their ability to participate in the broader economy, as did certain of the clauses of the Indian Act. And I think we need to really educate our students about all of these. And again, as I stressed at the outset, we need to really challenge the myths, the settler myths that have surrounded a lot of and the assumptions that have been made about participation in the economy, participation in agriculture, to really understand the history of that, to be able to move forward. And my hope, and I guess it's because it's in my field, is that we can do this through education.
And finally, if I asked you to give us a 30-second speech to someone or group in position of power in Canada, and your objective is to strengthen and improve Canadian excellence in research, history, or otherwise, who would you pitch and what would you say in just 30 seconds?
Well, I would pitch this to Premier Jason Kenney and to his ministers, particularly his education minister. And I would ask them not to dismantle our post-secondary education system. And do not dismantle the history and humanities curriculum in the public schools, in the primary schools and high schools. And I would argue that we need to educate the next generations. We're not just training students for vocations. We want to educate them. I would tell him that research and critical thinking are not the enemy. In fact, we should be not gutting our ability to produce research and critical thinking. Let us not encourage ignorance. I'm worried about something, an institution like the Campus Saint-Jean here at the University of Alberta, that is such an important Franco-Albertan institution, and it allows so many of our students to become bilingual if they're not already. And that's so important to their participation in Canadian life. So that would be my pitch. And I'm afraid that we are in danger of really gutting our universities with the present anti-intellectual approach and the cuts.